Hello people, welcome to the series of Ophthalmology Rewind. I hope you people must be doing good, staying at home and staying safe. Now, why actually we started with this series of ophthalmology lectures weekly? Because you must be knowing that we have already started with the next pattern exam. So in the upcoming exams, very soon we'll be getting the integrated pattern, and that is why we have already been giving the lectures in that integrated manner. Now the reason I chose this optic neuritis today, okay, the topic was optic neuritis. The reason is that it is giving you a wonderful integration with the multiple sclerosis, and you know it's a very, very important medicine topic. We study optic neuritis, we also study the demyelinating disorders, multiple sclerosis, and today we will be having a very unique way of integrating these two so that you can get a very good idea that how to actually find out if you are being given a case of multiple sclerosis, how will you reach to the diagnosis, what kind of optic neuritis it is, or if you are getting a question on the optic neuritis, how to reach up to the multiple sclerosis. So first of all, let us begin. Now, you know, whenever we talk about the optic neuritis, the first thing that comes to our mind is this multiple sclerosis. Okay, so first I am starting with the types of the optic neuritis. Now, these optic neuritis can present in three forms, as everybody knows. One is the papillitis, then we have the neuroretinitis, and then third is your retrobulbar neuritis. Okay, now let us see what is the meaning of these things. First of all, papilla. What do you mean by papilla? It is the inflammation of the papilla, papillitis. So papilla means the optic disc, or we can say the optic nerve head. So when there is an inflammation of this optic disc, that means only the intraocular part of the optic nerve. And we know that the shortest part of the optic nerve is this optic disc or optic nerve head, that is just 1 mm. So when I'm, this is just papillitis, not only the optic disc inflammation, along with this, we have also the macular involvement. This macular involvement usually takes place in the form of exudates. So because of these exudates, wherever we get this neuroretinitis, we have the macular star formation. Now here I am not actually talking about neuroretinitis. The reason is that the neuroretinitis is not found in the multiple sclerosis. It is not found. So basically we are talking about the papillitis and this retrobulbar neuritis. Now what do you mean by this retrobulbar neuritis? Retrobulbar neuritis. Okay, so this means that we are talking about the posterior part of the optic nerve, which is behind the eyeball, and we know that this is the largest part, 30 mm of the optic nerve. This is the largest part. Okay, so I can divide now the optic neuritis, which is found with the multiple sclerosis, in 1/3 and 2/3. So when you think about the multiple sclerosis and you want to correlate with the optic neuritis, don't think about neuroretinitis. That is not found in the multiple sclerosis. Now we have two things. We have retrobulbar neuritis and we have papillitis. And as you can see, more common is also retrobulbar neuritis. Obviously, more symptoms will also be found here because this is occupying the larger part of the optic nerve. As you know, largest part of the optic nerve is the retrobulbar part. That is your 30 mm, right? Okay, now how to remember? See, there are certain protocols which will be following all the three types of optic neuritis, And then we will be discussing how to differentiate it from the other types, like we can have hereditary type, we can have toxic type, we can have ischemic type. Now, instead of going from the signs and symptoms, I have devised an important way how you can remember the things. So you can easily remember the UCMP. Okay, like we have UCMS. So remember UCMP, because you know the problem is that how to recall so many things. We all have so much of stuff and registers are filled up, but you have to fill your minds, because ultimately it is only your mind that you can take in your exam. So how to register the things in your mind? So I want that now, today, after this session, you already have optic neuritis in your mind and you don't have to cram it up. Okay. So just remember UCMP. Now I will tell you how to go about it. First of all, take U. Okay. So first thing is that it is U for usually. It is usually unilateral. First important thing is that it is usually unilateral. Then second U. Second U is that we get the out of symptoms. We get the out of symptoms. Now, what do you mean by out of symptoms? Out of symptoms means that the symptoms are aggravated. The symptoms are aggravated by the heat, if you are exposing the patient to the heat, or by the exertion. So if the patient is exerting himself, is exposing himself to heat, then the symptoms are increasing. So this is a very important point, out of symptoms, and it is usually unilateral. Now mind you, I'm not saying that it is always unilateral. There is a difference between usually unilateral and always unilateral. Most of the times it is unilateral, it can be bilateral also. Okay, so now coming to the second thing. This was your first U. Now coming to the C. Now in the C, first of all, C for children. It is more common in the children and the young adults. Now one very, very important thing when you are dealing with optic neuritis with multiple sclerosis. Okay. So you have to remember that mostly the age group that is involved is the children and the young adults, and we tend to exclude multiple sclerosis if the age of the patient is lesser or more than this age group, that is about 18 to 45 years. This is very, very broad. If it is a very small child, then, and if the age is more than 50 years, we tend to exclude this, because they are more common is the ischemic optic neuropathy. So first is your C for children. Then second C, C is for the color vision loss. This is again very, very important, color. Now with this respect, also remember that what are the colors which are affected in the macular diseases. In the macular diseases, the colors which are affected are blue and yellow. How to remember this? You know the BMW car, okay? B for blue, M for macula, and this W for yellow. So BMW car, if it's a macular lesion, the more commonly affected colors are blue and yellow. If it's optic nerve disease, more commonly affected are your red and green color. So the age group, then we have the color vision loss. Now what is the other C? Then you also get the contrast sensitivity. Now because it is a defect in the optic nerve, the problem is also there in the contrast sensitivity, and that is also decreased. Color vision is affected, vision is also affected, contrast sensitivity is also affected, and we get the centrocecal scotoma. Now let us see what is this. Everybody knows what is scotoma. Scotoma means the blind spot where you are not able to see. Okay. Now we all have a physiological blind spot. What is physiological blind spot? The optic nerve head give rise to a blind spot in everyone's visual field. Now always remember that the scotoma, which is present due to the optic disc or the optic nerve head, that is present in everyone, but we are not able to realize it. We are not able to appreciate it. Because we are not able to appreciate it, that is why it is called as negative scotoma. So that is a basic difference between a positive scotoma and a negative scotoma. We all have a optic disc defect spot, due to which we have a blind spot. This we cannot perceive, we cannot appreciate, so that is a negative scotoma. Now, due to the optic neuritis, the scotoma which is occurring, that is a positive scotoma. Person will not be able to see, mainly in the central field, because optic nerve is mainly responsible for the central visual field. So this is called as central or centrocecal. Now, what is the meaning of centrocecal? Centrocecal means which is involving the blind spot. Now, this is again a very important thing, because many a times students don't know what is the meaning of centrocecal. So what is the difference between the two? If it is involving the blind spot also, then it is called as centrocecal scotoma. Otherwise, it is called as central scotoma. So these are the things with the C. Now we come to the M. Now let us see what are the things that we can have with M. Now first of all, we have already discussed that thing, M for multiple sclerosis. That is multiple sclerosis. It is most commonly found in the multiple sclerosis. Okay. Then the second thing, the males. It is more common in the males. Now, because it is a optic nerve disease, what is the type of pupillary reaction that you are going to get? So that M stands for the Marcus Gunn pupil. Marcus Gunn pupil. And these are the things which are every year asked in one or the other exam. Like last time also in AIIMS paper, there was a visual question on the Marcus Gunn pupil. What is Marcus Gunn pupil? RAPD. And we know that RAPD is the earliest manifestation. It is the earliest manifestation of the optic nerve disease. So obviously, the first thing that I'm going to get when we get a patient of optic neuritis, it is multiple sclerosis, mostly it is found in male. Then you have seen it was unilateral, Uthoff symptoms, color vision loss, the age group we have seen, contrast sensitivity is also decreased, okay, that you have seen, what type of scotoma you will get, okay. Then the Marcus Gunn pupil. Now, another M is the methylprednisolone. So also remember, the methylprednisolone, you will be requiring this for the treatment. So another M is methylprednisolone. So now it becomes very handy for you to remember whether it is unilateral or bilateral, where you have Uthoff symptoms, what kind of scotoma you have, what is the age group, what is the gender, what is the pupillary defect that you are going to get. Now, how do you give this methylprednisolone? First, we give the IV route. IV route is given only for the 3 days, okay? And then you give the oral. Oral is given for 11 days. Now, it has been seen that when you give only the oral, then the results are not good. That is why we first have to give the 3 days. This is depending upon the ONTT group, optic neuritis treatment trial group. Based on this optic neuritis treatment trial group, we give this, and then you have to taper the oral in the next 3 days. So you have to give the total of 17 days treatment. Okay. Now another important thing, another M is the MRI. MRI is very, very important for the diagnosis. Because many a times they will ask you that what is the investigation of choice that you are going to do. Now this is a question of radiology also. This could be asked as a question of medicine, and this can be ophthalmology also. So what is your investigation of choice? See, I'm not talking about the test for the optic nerve function. Many of the people got confused when I asked a question, this question I posted in the morning also, that what is the investigation of choice for the optic neuritis in multiple sclerosis? And many people get confused with perimetry. Perimetry is best for assessing the function of the optic nerve, but it is not the investigation of choice with respect to multiple sclerosis. I want to see the demyelination there. So remember, MRI of the brain as well as the orbit, MRI of the brain and the orbit, especially the with the gadolinium enhancement and the fat suppression. So this is the investigation of choice. Another important MCQ, I think every line is a MCQ. If you go through the questions on the optic neuritis, every line you will find a MCQ. So this way you have got the investigation of choice also. Okay, so after covering the M, now we come to the P. There are so many things and this is very, very important. Okay, now let us see what are the things you have to cover from P. First of all, P means the profound visual loss, profound diminution of vision. Now, if you remember what we study in the neuro also, whenever there is a lesion of the optic nerve, there is a total blindness on the side of lesion with the normal vision on the other side. That is why we said that there was unilateral vision loss and also there was severe vision loss, total vision loss, or I can say profound vision loss. In a way, it was a total vision loss. Whenever there is a lesion of the optic nerve, we get total vision loss on that side. Other side is normal. This is first. Now, second thing is pain. Now, many a times there is a doubt. I will say always there is a doubt about the pain in the optic neuritis. Now, whether the vision loss is painless, painful ocular movements, there are so many things. So try to understand. See, one thing is that you are having the painful vision loss, and another thing is that you are having pain along with the vision loss. You are having the painful ocular movements along with the vision loss. So that kind of picture you are getting in optic neuritis. So here we are getting the pain. This is actually the periorbital pain, or it is your brow pain, or I can say retrobulbar. And this pain, retrobulbar periorbital pain, which is actually more common in the retrobulbar neuritis. The reason also I will show you, this pain, see, the vision loss is not painful, but vision loss is associated with pain. Many of the times it's a periorbital, deep orbital, or the retrobulbar pain that we are having, and this is aggravated with the painful ocular movements. Another P is painful ocular movements, especially the medial rectus and the superior rectus. Now I will tell you the reason. The reason is that suppose this is the orbit, we know it is pyramidal, and this is the eyeball. Okay, now here we have the annulus of Zinn. Okay, now from this annulus of Zinn are coming the different extraocular muscles, and they are getting inserted into the sclera, something like this. You all know this. Okay, now what is happening behind the eyeball? The optic nerve is also coming out of the sclera through the lamina crebrosa, and it is going behind. This is the retrobulbar part of the optic nerve. So that means the sclera is common in both. Extraocular muscles are getting inserted into the sclera, optic nerve is coming out of the sclera. So those muscles which are very close to this optic nerve sheath, they have a chance of getting inflammation from this optic nerve. The muscles will get the inflammation, and that is why these two muscles which are very close to the optic nerve, they will give you maximum tenderness. So please don't get confused. There can be a pain, okay, and obviously we also have the aggravation with the painful ocular movements. Then another important thing with P is the pulfric phenomenon. Now these are two P's. What is this? Pulfric phenomena means there is a defect in the depth perception. Now, this is again a very important thing. If the person is not having the proper depth perception, he will not be able to assess the depth of the objects, the depth of the space, then obviously he will have a problem in day-to-day life. This person will have a problem in climbing the stairs, in descending the stairs. He doesn't know how much depth he has to keep the foot while uplifting also, while going down also. So that is actually called as a pulfric phenomenon. And again, a direct question on root of symptoms as well as the pulfric phenomena, both can come. Then another important P is the pupillary reaction. Pupillary reaction, one pupillary reaction I have already told you, Marcus Dunn pupil you were getting. Pupillary reaction to the light, if I talk about the light reflex to the light, is ill sustained. Sometimes what you get, obviously, you can get a total absence of the light reflex also, because optic nerve is the afferent nerve, okay? But sometimes what you get, that in the optic nerve lesions, we get slight constriction. We are getting the constriction due to the light, but it is not able to sustain, and that is why then it changes into the dilatation of the pupil. That is called as ill sustained. Pupillary reactions to the light are ill sustained. Then another important P is the perimetry. Another important thing is the perimetry. So this P is again important. This perimetry is the best test. It is the best test to assess the function of the optic nerve. The best test to assess the function of the optic nerve is perimetry. Now, can you see the difference? There was a difference when I was saying that the investigation of choice was MRI, brain in orbit, to see the demyelinating areas, okay, for the multiple sclerosis. But now my question is, what is the best test for assessing the function of optic nerve? Then I'm saying it's perimetry. Why? Because optic nerve is responsible for the visual field, and visual field can be seen, whole of the field, by the perimetry. And that is why the best test that we can do to assess the function of the optic nerve is actually the perimetry. Okay, then one more thing. Another P means the prolonged latency, and there will be decrease amplitude. Prolonged latency and decrease amplitude on the visual evoked potential. So these are the things that you are going to get, and they are very, very important. And now let us revise. It was U, it was C, it was M, and it was P. So it was unilateral, Woodoff symptoms, then in children, the color vision loss, central or the central cecal scotomas were there, decreased contrast sensitivity was also there, multiple sclerosis was the most common cause that we were getting. Okay, then what are the other things we were getting? It was more common in males. Marcus Dunn pupil, RAPD, you know that RAPD is the earliest manifestation of any of the optic nerve disease. Then we were getting the methylprednisolone based on ONTT trial. You have to give this drug, and then there was MRI. Then coming to the P, it was profound visual loss, there was pain, pupillary reactions were ill-sustained, painful ocular movements, pulfric phenomenon, perimetry, and then the prolonged latency and the decreased amplitude. So whenever we get a question on the optic neuritis, just remember UCMP and you will be able to solve many of the questions. Now, if I talk about the fundus appearance, how to go about it. Now, before I share the fundus pictures of the neuroretinitis or retrobulbar neuritis or the papillitis, first of all, see the normal fundus. How do you get a normal fundus? Normal fundus, we get the optic disc, we get a healthy macula, we have got the great vessels, the central retinal artery, central retinal vein, and there is nothing significant that you are getting. Okay, you get a healthy shining reflex coming from the center of the macula, that is your foveal reflex. Okay, that is actually the normal fundus. Now look at here, can you see we do not see any margin of the optic disc, that is missing. So you can see the blurred margins. Okay, you can see the blurred margins, you can see the edema of the optic disc, you can see the congestion, hyperemia. So these are the things that you are going to get in cases of papillitis. Now don't cram it. It is but obvious when I'm saying it is papillitis, inflammation of the optic disc. So that means all the signs of inflammation, we all know there are 5 signs of inflammation that you are going to get on the optic disc. So I will get redness also, I will get the shining reflexes, I will get the edema of the optic disc, I will get the blurring of margins, I will also get the exudation, and that is why, can you see, you are getting a yellowish color. So this kind of optic atrophy that you are getting, this is called as the secondary optic atrophy. The kind of optic atrophy that you are getting in cases of papillitis is the secondary optic atrophy, because look at the color, this is your dirty white color. So this is the kind of a color that you are going to get, because in cases of primary optic atrophy, it is just white, chalky white in color. Here it is dirty white in color. So this is the main difference between the two. Now coming to the next one. Now see here. Now if you see this, here also you are getting the edema. Edema is present here also. Okay, but can you see the amount of edema is much more, it is much more in comparison to the optic disc. So this is actually a case of the papilledema. This is a case of the papilledema, and in cases of the papilledema also you get the optic disc edema, but always remember certain things, how to differentiate it from papilledema. First of all, P for papilledema is P for passive. It is passive. P for papilledema is P for passive. This is the passive edema. While in cases of optic neuritis, we were getting optic nerve disease, active optic nerve disease. This is passive. Second important thing, it is actually due to the raised intracranial tension. So this is passive optic disc edema, which is occurring secondary to the raised intracranial pressure. Now because it is secondary to something, it is passive, that is why it is bilateral. Now can you see the difference? In the optic neuritis, I was saying that it was usually unilateral, but if I'm talking about papilledema, it is always bilateral. So another confusion that comes to the mind, that whether it is a case of optic neuritis, papillitis, neuroretinitis, retrobulbar neuritis or papilledema, that should not be there, because if it is a case of papilledema, it should be bilateral. You should get a history of a raised intracranial tension, you should get the passive optic disc edema. Now how will I come to know that whether I have this raised intracranial pressure or not? So always remember that there are 3 important causes of raised ICT. Always remember 3 T's. Either it is trauma, head trauma, okay, or it is tubercular meningitis infection, or it can be a tumor. So tumor should be thought in the last, okay. It can be any space occupying lesions also, anything that is causing the raised intraocular pressure, intracranial pressure, can lead to bilateral optic disc edema. Okay, now what are the other things by which I can differentiate whether, suppose I am not able to get the whether it is trauma or not, or space occupying lesion, just on the basis of the optic disc features, how will I come to know whether it is optic neuritis or papilledema? Let's see that. So a very important thing that you will get in papilledema is the enlargement of the blind spot. Enlargement of the blind spot is a very, very important feature that you are going to get in papilledema. And in fact, this question was asked in the AIIMS November 2019 also. This question came in AIIMS, that what are the features of the enlargement of blind spot. So papilledema is a very important feature for the enlargement of blind spot. Why? Blind spot means the optic disc had scotoma. So because here the edema of this optic disc is very, very large, it is 7 to 8 times in comparison to the optic neuritis. So obviously the enlargement of the blind spot that you are getting is very, very high. Okay, second important thing, you will not get the exudation in the early phases. So in the early phases, if you see the papillitis, you will get the exudation, you will get hyperemia, you will get the blurring of margins, the edema is less. But in cases of the papal edema, we will have the first nasal blurring only, okay? And after that, there will be obscuration of the cup, obliteration of the margins. But the amount of edema is very, very high, and that is why it is called as enlargement of the blind spot. Now, what are the other things by which I can say that, see, this is not a case of optic neuritis, it is papal edema. So you should have the signs of the raised intracranial tension. If it is a case of papal edema, obviously you will have the signs of raised intracranial tension also, because here the optic disc edema which takes place is secondary to the raised intracranial pressure. So what are the signs? Let us revise this. This is your medicine. You will always get the spasmodic type. Headache, okay. You will get this spasmodic kind of a headache, and the patient will tell you about this. Then another important thing, you will have the projectile vomiting, okay. Then third important thing, we will be having the amaurosis fugax. Now, what do you mean by this amaurosis fugax? This means the intermittent attacks of the diminution of vision that you are getting. This is very, very different from the case of optic neuritis, where you were getting unilateral, profound, or the complete vision loss. So if you are having the spasmodic kind of a headache, the pulsatile kind of headache, and you are having the projectile vomiting, you are getting the amaurosis fugax, plus if you look at the Uthoff symptoms, what you read just now, that Uthoff symptoms will be present in optic neuritis. So here they are absent. You will not be having any Uthoff symptoms. If I talk about the pulfric phenomenon, then that is also absent here. If I talk about the color vision loss, the color vision loss is again absent here. So all these things will obviously help you to differentiate whether it is optic neuritis or papal edema. Now, once the diagnosis is clear, treatment is not a problem, because here treatment is only of the cause. Treatment is only of the cause, because this was secondary to the raised intracranial pressure. So if you have solved that problem, obviously the edema will also resolve. So this was another thing. Now see this. Here, can you see this beautiful star appearance? Now see, this is the optic disc. How to read the fundus? How I always start? You always start with the optic disc. You can see very good margins. You can see the cup. You can see the vessels. So this area on the temporal side is the macula. Macula is showing you the puckering appearance. It is showing a star-like appearance. So this is a macular star. Is of malignant hypertension. It is also found in the cases of the malignant hypertension. So here it is not concerned, because we are considering only papillitis and the retrobulbar neuritis, because in multiple sclerosis we are not having neuroretinitis. Okay. Now, if you are having all the features, suppose you are having all the features, unilateral diminution of vision, you are having Uthoff symptoms, you are having pulfric phenomenon, color vision is lost, scotomas are there, decreased contrast sensitivity is there, but you are getting normal fundus, then what should you think? Now, if I am considering multiple sclerosis, okay, and I am getting this normal fundus. So I will think, see, out of the three things, one was papillitis, one was neuroretinitis, and one was retrobulbar neuritis. Neuroretinitis is not found in multiple sclerosis. Now you are left with papillitis and retrobulbar neuritis. Papillitis may, you will have hyperemic disc, you will have blurring of margins, you will have dirty white optic disc, secondary optic atrophy. So what is left is the retrobulbar neuritis. So in retrobulbar neuritis also, we get the normal fundus. Why we get the normal fundus? Because name itself is saying that it is retrobulbar neuritis. You are getting the changes behind the eyeball, and that is why optic disc looks normal. And that is why very beautifully designed to say that neither the patient sees anything nor the ophthalmologist. So if you are getting all the signs and symptoms of optic neuritis, but in the last they say that the fundus is normal, then without any hesitation, go with the retrobulbar neuritis. you will be having the painful ocular movements also, and the recurrent attacks. If the patient is having the recurrent attacks of this retrobulbar neuritis, then it can lead to the optic atrophy. But in the initial phases, the fundus will be normal. Sometimes you have this confusion also, ki ma'am, some books say that optic atrophy is there, but some books say that the normal fundus. So both are correct. You will get a normal fundus initially, the retrobulbar neuritis, because these changes are found behind the eyeball. But obviously, if this retrobulbar neuritis attacks are occurring again and again, then a time will come that optic atrophy will there. But whatever be the type, whether it is papillitis or whether it is retrobulbar neuritis, the treatment will remain same. Okay, now coming to the other types, what are the other things that one should think of? Suppose a person is having optic neuritis, what are the other things we should think of? So another important thing is the Leber's hereditary optic neuritis. This is a hereditary form of the optic neuritis, and it is having certain different thing features, and these features will be given if they want to make a diagnosis of this disease. So let us think, see what are they. Some are M and some are P. So you have to remember the MP here. Now what is this M? M is that we are having the mitochondrial inheritance. Mitochondrial inheritance pattern. So I hope some of the people must be knowing this as an example of mitochondrial inheritance pattern, and that is why it is so popular, because of the mitochondrial inheritance one thing. Now because of this, it is maternally transmitted. It is maternally transmitted. So another M is the maternally transmitted. Okay. Now because it is having mitochondrial inheritance, it is maternally transmitted, manifested more commonly in males. Now again, I'm not saying that it cannot occur in females, I'm saying more commonly. So mitochondrial inheritance, maternally transmitted and manifested more commonly in males, these were the M. Now coming to the P. Okay, now what are the things that you have to go with the P? Okay, now for the P, you have to see, first of all, here it is painless. Now up till now we have read that there was some kind of retrobulbar pain, deep orbital pain, but this is essentially painless. So this is one differentiating feature from that. Okay, then second thing, you get the pseudo papillitis. We get the pseudo papillitis. Pseudo means false. So we are getting the appearance as if there is inflammation, but actually there is no inflammation here. Papillitis means you get an appearance of hyperemia with the blood margins. So apparently we get these, but it is a kind of the pseudo papillitis. Then another P, we get the primary optic atrophy. Here we get the primary optic atrophy. Now you should also know what are the causes of this primary optic atrophy. Now we can divide the optic atrophy into primary optic atrophy, the secondary, as well as the tertiary. Okay, primary, you know, occurs mainly due to brain diseases, secondary due to the optic disc diseases, and tertiary is due to the retinal diseases. This is your chalky white in color. The colors are again very important. They can ask you specifically. Optic disc mein you are getting the dirty white in color, and in the retinal diseases we get pale yellow waxy. Okay, now there is always a confusion between the causes. So always remember that whenever we have brain lesions, it can be the trauma of the brain, it can be tumor, okay, or another T is toxic. If there is a toxic optic neuropathy, and then we also have this Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy. These are very important causes. Now in cases of optic disc lesions, we have papillitis. Whenever we have papillitis or we have the papilledema, or we can have the ischemia of the optic disc, that is anterior ischemic optic neuropathy. On the other hand, if you go with the tertiary now, tertiary mein we have the retinal diseases. It can be retinitis pigmentosa, it can be CRAO, arterial occlusion, it can be also be the venous occlusion. So one very, very important question is the type of optic atrophy. In the toxic optic neuropathy, another important thing is that apart from the optic neuropathy that is found in the multiple sclerosis, the two main, that is your Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy and your toxic, they are quite similar and both of them are showing the primary optic atrophy. So this is another thing. Now, if I talk about the pupillary reactions, so pupillary reactions are normal here. Pupillary reactions are normal while we get the peripapillary microangiopathy. Now, let us see what is this. Whenever you get a large word, always split that word. Okay, peripapillary. Peri means the periphery. Okay, and papillary means the optic disc. Micro, small, angio, vessels, and pathy, you know, is the disease. Now see, you have got the answer. It is a disease of small blood vessels in the periphery of the optic disc that is also found here, and they are called as the telangiectasias. You must have heard this word in the Coats disease also. There we get the leukocoria, that is important. So we are getting so many P's here. So always remember MNP, Madhya Pradesh, for the Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy. Okay, now finally we come to the toxic optic neuropathy. Toxic optic neuropathy is basically drug induced. Nowadays there is a tendency of asking that drug induced optic neuropathies, drug induced cataract, drug induced cornea keratopathies. So that is why this is again very important, and there are so many things, so many drugs which are causing this optic neuropathy. Like for example, if you start with the poisoning, we have the methyl alcohol. How will you get this methyl alcohol poisoning? Like spirit poisoning. This is very common in domestic outlays. Okay, methyl alcohol, and you already know ethyl alcohol. Nothing to say if the person is chronic alcoholic. Okay, then we have chloroquine. Now I always mention this, that chloroquine is one drug which is very much significant in ophthalmology, because chloroquine is causing the vortex keratopathy also, bullseye maculopathy, toxic cataract, so many things, and we will be discussing this in detail in another session where I have I'll be talking about the side effects of the drugs only. So chloroquine, we also have the chloramphenicol. Chloramphenicol, though it is not so commonly used nowadays, but still it is there. Then we have D for digoxin. Always try to follow some order so that you can able to remember. Like we have C for chloroquine, D for digoxin, E for alcohol, ethyl alcohol. So you can start with A for alcohol, then we have C for chloroquine, D for digoxin, E for ethambutol. Then this ATT, we also have the isoniazid. Isoniazid is also causing. Then another important drug is amiodarone. Now nowadays amiodarone is a very frequently asked drug. So two very, very important things are the amiodarone and chloroquine. That does not mean that others are not important, but this is more important. Okay, so all these drugs are causing this toxic neuropathy. Then a certain vitamin deficiencies, like we can have deficiency of vitamin, especially the vitamin B12, we have vitamin B1, we have the folic acid. If we have the deficiency of these vitamins, then also we can have the toxic optic neuropathy. And one thing which is very common in India is the deficiency of vitamin B12, because most of us are vegetarians, and the B12 is mainly present in the animal products. That is why most of us has the deficiency of this vitamin B12. Now what is the problem? tobacco chewers, they also cause the optic neuropathy. How they are actually affecting? Basically, they are affecting the ganglionic cells. Okay, and you know that the ganglionic cells are present in the optic nerve. So basically, they are affecting the ganglionic cells, especially at the macula. They are affecting the ganglionic cells, especially at the macula, because basically they are affecting the papillomacular bundle. Papillomacular bundle. If I say this is your retina, okay. So this is the central part, and here you have this blind spot. Now, what happens? We have in the retina the nasal fibers. The nasal fibers are like this, while the temporal fibers are arc-like, like this. So this is the basic configuration which you should always remember on the nasal side and on the temporal side. If you remember this, even the visual field defects that you are getting in glaucoma will be becoming very, very simple for you. On the nasal side, we have radiating fibers. We have the radiating fibers on the nasal side, while on the temporal side we have the arcuate fibers. Radiating fibers, we have superior radiating fiber, inferior radiating fiber. Here we have arcuate fiber, superior arcuate fiber, inferior arcuate fiber. Okay, so temporal fibers, that is your arcuate fibers, these fibers are the earliest which are affected in glaucoma, and that is why nasal field is first affected. Okay, so now in the center we have these straighter fibers. This is actually the papillomacular bundle, and this is mainly affected, and that is why we are getting the diminution of vision by the toxic optic neuropathy. Now another important thing is your ischemic type of optic neuropathy. So we have seen that how to differentiate the multiple sclerosis from the Leber's hereditary optic neuritis, from the toxic optic neuritis. Now, how to differentiate between ischemic variety? Now see, if there is ischemia, it can be anterior ischemic optic neuropathy or it can be posterior ischemic optic neuropathy. Okay, so the anterior one will resemble, this will resemble more like the papillitis. While if you look at this posterior, this will resemble more like retrobulbar neuritis. So that is common sense also. The anterior one which is visible will be more like papillitis. The one which is posterior not visible, that is more like retrobulbar neuritis. Now we know that this is more common. Now from this anterior ischemic optic neuropathy, again we can have two types. Arthritic. One is arthritic type and another is your non-arthritic. Now don't go into much details, only if you go with the broad classification, then also you will be able to do all the questions. See this, anterior one is resembling the papillitis. Now very less common is this arthritic, only 5%. 90 to 95% of the cases are associated with the non-arthritic, that is occlusion of the short posterior ciliary artery, the vessels, that is the blood supply of the optic disc is occluded. So this arthritic one is associated with the giant cell arthritis. So that is a different story altogether. You read this topic in medicine in detail, you will see the CRP increased, ESR increased, you will also do the biopsy of the temporal artery, and you will be getting so many things. You will get the jaw claudication, pain, lump like here, that is cord like structure that is formed. So I don't think that there will be a problem in the diagnosis of this arthritic type. Now, whether it is arthritic or whether it is non-arthritic, if they are saying that it is a ischemic optic neuropathy, then two things are always there. One is the pale disc, because there is a ischemia, so there will be pale disc along with the edema. So in cases of the toxic or the Leber's hereditary, you were getting pseudo papillitis, but here we are getting the pale disc and we are getting edema. Second important thing is we will get the altitudinal hemianopias. So this is again very, very important, and you get a direct question, altitudinal hemianopia is found and it is a feature of ischemic optic neuropathy. Now let me show you what do you mean by it. Altitudinal Hamianopias means that you get something like this. See this, we are getting to altitude, superior altitude, inferior altitude. So mostly we get the inferior altitudinal hamianopias, but nevertheless any one of them can be present. We can divide the visual fields into two altitudes, superior altitude and inferior altitude. So there can be hamianopias. Hami means half. So either the superior half becomes blind or the inferior half becomes blind. If the superior half is blind, then it is superior hamianopia. If the inferior, then it is inferior hamianopia. Now, what is the treatment that you are going to give? If I discuss the treatment, like one which was having the multiple sclerosis, that we have already discussed, that we will give IV dose of the methylprednisolone. Methylprednisolone, first I will give the IV dose, okay? And this is given for 3 days, and then I will switch to the oral methylprednisolone. This I will continue for 11 days. And then I will taper this oral methylprednisolone in the next 3 days. Now, the question is, should I give methylprednisolone to every patient? Should it make any difference if I not give the methylprednisolone? So how will I decide? Now see, these steroids, when I give these steroids, they only decrease the recovery period or the recovery time. Okay, so normally, like if the visual acuity will recover in 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, the recovery will become early. If you are giving the steroids, it does not affect the final visual acuity. This is a very, very important point, and before giving the steroids, you should always consider this fact, that what is the cost benefit ratio of giving the steroids, whether early recovery is required or not. Okay, so what can I say? When you do the MRI, so when you do the MRI and previously there was no attack of optic neuritis, if this is a first attack of optic neuritis and you are getting the lesions, then you should give the steroids. In the recurrent cases, when you have already given the cases of steroids, then most of the times we wait for the spontaneous resolution. Now, if I talk about the Leber's hereditary optic neuritis, this is a hereditary disease. Here, we usually do not have any treatment. Then, if I talk about the toxic optic neuropathy, which is sometimes also called as toxic amblyopias, they are occurring due to the deficiency of vitamin B12. So, here we give the injections, intramuscular injections we are giving of the B12. Now, how we are giving? This is given weekly for 10 weeks. So, because the main pathology here is quite different, that is why we are giving different treatment this. And as far as the ischemic is concerned, that will depend upon the cause, whether it is arthritic or it is non-arthritic. Now, what is the take-home message? You have read the optic neuritis with multiple sclerosis, with hereditary, with toxic, along with the ischemic. First of all, whenever you get a question on optic neuritis, the first thing that should come to your mind is the multiple sclerosis. If you are getting the things like male gender, then always remember UCMP. That means if it is unilateral, Uthoff symptoms, then you are getting the male gender, you are getting this, you are getting the mitochondrial inheritance pattern or not. Then if you are getting the color vision loss, if you are getting the centrosecal scotomas, you are getting the decreased contrast sensitivity. And then if you are getting the painful ocular movements, the pulfric phenomenon, then the pupillary reaction and EMBOL, that was the Marcus gun pupil, then your diagnosis will be with respect to the multiple sclerosis. Then look at the painful ocular movements, whether it is not there or not. Look at the age group. That is again very, very important. If they have given you the age group, then you are trying to differentiate it between the papillitis and the retrovulvar neuritis. Plus, in the last, also look on the fundus. If they are saying that there are no fundus features and we have the normal fundus, go with the retrobulbar neuritis. If they are saying that we have got the optic disc edema, we have got this hyperemia, blurring of margins, and obviously it is papillitis. Now, second thing, if they have given you something about the mitochondrial inheritance, then your diagnosis will go in the favor of the Leber's hereditary optic neuritis. Then look at whether the patient given is a male or not, which one is a carrier, pupillary reactions involved or not, painless or not, what are the type of optic atrophy they have mentioned. Then if they have given you the use of any of the toxin or a drug, ethyl alcohol, methyl alcohol, digoxin, chloroquine, then you should think about the toxic optic neuropathy, and then your answer about the treatment will become different. And finally, if they have talked about the pale disc and if they have talked about the altitudinal amenopias, your diagnosis should go in favor of the ischemic optic neuropathy. So in this way, we have differentiated the different types of optic neuritis. What are the important features that you should always keep in your mind whenever you are diagnosing a case of optic neuritis? Then how to differentiate it from the papilledema? Why this is not a case of papilledema? Why this is a case of papilledema? What kind of optic atrophy I will get here? What is the basic difference between the Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy, toxic optic neuropathy, ischemic optic neuropathy? So I hope now as a whole, you could be solving any question related to the optic neuritis. Any query, any question related to this is always welcome. You can post your queries in the comment section and I'll be more than happy to answer them. Also tell about your feedback. We are always happy to hear about the things that we are doing, because obviously we are putting in something, so we want to hear from you that how do you like the session, and also tell me what are the other topics that you want me to discuss so that your preparation is not affected even during the COVID days. And I want you to remain in your tips, because obviously the time is not that much on the way, but even when the time is off the way, we have to be on the way for all our preparation, and this COVID should not affect our preparation. So be focused, be motivated. That is very, very important. Don't fall from your track. Okay, make proper timetables and let me know what all I can do and what are the topics that you want me. Like, I have scheduled some of the topics that I thought are good for integrated pattern ophthalmology teaching. Let me know if any other topics you want me to take up, and I'll be more than happy to take them. Thank you and happy ophthalmology.